Hey guys, Maria Lena returning to you once again from Purple Hood Adventures. Happy St. Patrick's Day once again. Colin says so too. He's a little bit bigger this year. He still likes to see himself in the camera. He's a toddler this year. He's no longer, yeah, you are a toddler. No longer an infant. He just woke up from a nap, guys, so this might be interesting. but it's my favorite holiday. I'm so excited to be with you guys again today. We're going to have some really good things we're going to talk about. If you remember last year, we talked about he's playing with my notes and probably going to eat the paper, guys. And this is our globe here. I took the liberty of using Mardi Gras beads because I don't have green beads right now. Colin really likes to travel the world and spin the globe, so that'll be interesting. So today, guys, we're going to talk about some things that came from Ireland, okay? Things that originated in Ireland with Irishmen, kind of like we did with our St. Patrick's Day video. Things that came from Mexico, we're going to do the same theme this year with St. Patrick's Day. So I'm very excited about that. Last year, if you remember, we talked about things, unique facts about Ireland itself. It's a good thing I have this memorized. These are my prop notes, guys. We talked about interesting things about Ireland itself. We made, I think we made boxies the year before. Hi, Colin. The year before, we did a trivia Irish game. Hi. We talked about top U.S. cities to celebrate St. Patrick's Day. We made coal cannon and soda bread, if you remember that one. The year before that, 2021, we talked about facts of Ireland and St. Patrick himself. And I think we made nothing, apparently. I don't know, guys. I guess that was, like, before I started cooking. So, I don't know. I went back to go look at them. Like, oh, I guess we didn't make anything that year. And the year before that, it was 2020 when I first got back from Costa Rica. And we were, like, not even talking about anything about Ireland. So, we're working on moving on up in the world, guys. We're going to do a little bit more today. I'm so excited. This is my favorite holiday. Today we're also going to make BARMBRACK, okay, which is locally known as Breck, which is, or Brack, I guess it is, which is like a sweet Halloween bread, which is like my favorite holiday ever. Guys, having a one-year-old is like, it's really difficult making a vlog while having one of these guys, so I'm going to just do the best I can, and he will be around to taste my BARMBRACK. I'm sure he's going to like to eat it a lot more than last year's dish when he was barely eating solid foods. Colin, can you say hi? Say hi. Hi. Yeah, you're waving. He's waving. Being a good man. All right, guys, we will see you in the kitchen, and we'll first start talking about our first thing that came from Ireland. Can you say, see you in the kitchen, Colin? Say bye-bye. Bye-bye. Okay, I'm really excited right now. We're gonna get started with making our BARMBRACK. Okay, I'm sure I'm butchering that. I'm not Irish natively, but I'll do my best at the pronunciations. Okay, so BARMBRACK is actually like a sweet kind of bread. It's not quite as sweet as a Christmas bread, but it's more like a Halloween bread, which actually began as a Celtic tradition back during the time of the fruit harvest, and it was a way to preserve fruit and also eggs as the winter rolled in. And what's really interesting about this is that they bury a charm in it for good fortune or bad fortune, I guess, like a ring or a coin or a pea or a piece of fabric. It's kind of like the king cake of Mardi Gras that when you put the plastic baby in there. I really like king cakes, and I've made those before too. We'll talk about that later. But this is what we're going to do the day before. Okay, this is our first little tiny bit of prep, by the way. So we are going to prepare this stuff and let it sit overnight. So what I have here is 1 3/4 cups of raisins. Okay, here is my 1 3/4 cups of sultanas, I guess is how you say it. I read that, guys, and I thought sultans, like I thought like, you know, like Aladdin style, but no, those are, I looked it up, it's just white grapes, which I thought, didn't know where green grapes or white grapes are the same thing, but they are, you guys. So actually, they're just green grapes, but they call them sultanas. So that's what those are. I never really thought about it. Then we have over here some dark brown sugar, actually 1 1/3 cup. It doesn't look, I always like measuring that out because it looks like sandcastles, also feels like sandcastles. We're going to use 2 cups of black, strong, hot breakfast tea. That sounds like a romance novel. I just picked out this one there. And we're going to zest a lemon and an orange. Okay, and we're going to mix this together and let it sit overnight. Make sure you remove the sticker, because if you don't, you'll end up like my cat and maybe like puke it on the floor. So don't do that. So we're going to get to zesting those and then combine those things. And by the way, you guys, if you've never zested a lemon or an orange before, you might want to have one of these handy dandy zesters. This is what it looks like. I never really thought that you could eat lemon peel until I had one of these, and it turns out it's in a lot of things. So if you've never done that before, that's how you do it. All right, now that we have successfully turned our orange and our lemon into what looks like carrot shreds and, I don't know, like pineapple something. I don't know, it just kind of looks that way. All right, we're going to mix all this together in this bowl. I hope these grapes or these sultanas or whatever they are not supposed to be chopped. They say that they're not. I mean, they don't say either way, but I guess they look kind of big, so we'll just see how this goes, and we're going to pour our hot tea over that. Okay, this is our 2 cups of hot tea. I did put 2 tea bags in it just to make it extra strong, and then I poured it into a bowl, which I'm probably going to spill. Okay, guys. Me and hot liquids do not mix typically. However, we are going to mix this little concoction here, and then we're going to cover it with, quote, clingy wrap. I think they mean like plastic wrap. So we're going to mix this and then let it sit overnight at room temperature. Okay, guys, that brings us to our first thing that came from Ireland, and that would be flavored potato chips. And when I say chips, I don't mean fries like in other countries. I'm talking about like potato chips in America. They call them crisps in other countries. So a man by the name of, I guess his name was Joseph Spud Murphy in 1954, was fed up with the plain old boring potato chips. I don't blame him. I don't really like those either. And so he created like cheese and onion flavors. So we can thank all of our like interesting flavors on the one man that came from there. Gosh, you guys, I wish I could become a millionaire by inventing new flavors of things. I'm like notorious for concocting weird things that taste controversial together. So yeah, but anyway, you can thank the guy from Ireland next time you have like a Dorito or like a Cheez-It. I guess that would count. I don't know, guys. But yeah, you can thank an Irishman. Poor Colin is over there eating rocks. He's about ready to have some flavored crisps. Okay, we've successfully turned this into what looks like alien stew. Either that, or this kind of reminds me of like one of those things that you put out to trap fruit flies in your kitchen. So I'm gonna hope that this clingy wrap does the job and keeps any fruit flies from actually getting in there. By the way, guys, don't mind this. I made this for my husband for his birthday. We'll revisit that one at Cinco de Mayo, but right now it's St. Patrick's Day, and we're gonna let this sit overnight. And yeah, room temperature, so don't put it in the fridge unless your fridge is like broken or something. So, all right, guys, we'll see you tomorrow. Okay, guys, we're gonna record this one on the floor again so that Colin can participate. He's a scientist, by the way. He's got one of these little spiral things. So we're going to talk about our next plant that comes from Ireland. That would be modern chemistry. Okay, so Boyle, if you remember him, he came from Ireland, and Boyle invented Boyle's Law. If you remember, that talks about how as gas pressure increases, volume decreases. And he wrote a book called The Skeptical Chemist. Skeptical with a C. He's mad that this is broken. But I'm having a really hard time fixing it with one hand. So he wrote this book, and then that prompted a group of chemists in Ireland called the Invisible College to study more chemistry. And I think maybe Boyle didn't really love his home country all that much, and he, quote, called it, okay, I'm going to have to read this one, guys, a barbarous country where chemical spirits were so misunderstood and chemical instruments so unprocurable that it was hard to have any hermetic thought on it. Ouch, you guys. I'm not so sure what he thought about Ireland, but that's what he said. So Boyle, modern chemistry, that really originated in our favorite country, Ireland. And as you see, Colin is going to be a chemist. He's on his phone right now studying. So, yeah. Thank Ireland for our scientific methods. I don't know about that either. We're going to be studying Boyle's Law soon. I think the volume of this paper is rapidly diminishing. Let's see what Colin thinks about this lovely concoction here. It feels warm, by the way, guys. I'm not sure. It's a few hours after I put this in here. What do you think, Colin? I'm eating Cheerios. What do you think? Is it yummy? Oh, boy. Oh, boy. Not yet. We'll have it tomorrow. Okay, it's now the next day, and as you see, my alien stew is still sitting there. It's actually been like almost 24 hours, guys, so it's probably a little longer than it's supposed to be. We'll see how it turns out. I probably did it a little bit early. But here is the rest of our ingredients here. This is no longer warm, by the way. I don't know what was happening yesterday, but maybe there's like some yeast happening in there. I don't really know. Okay, so you'll have to excuse. My husband decided to run the dishwasher like he did last year. So if you hear noises and you see this extra jumbo size pot, it's because everything is being washed at the moment. So I'll just explain that. Okay, so we're going to make our promise of Christmas / Halloween barmbrack. Okay, that's what they kind of call it. It's kind of like an excitement for Christmas and celebration of fall, which is my favorite season, and also Halloween, which was Samhain, the Celtic tradition. So without further ado, this is 3 cups of flour. It's fresh flour because I was out of flour and had to go make a special trip. We have here 2 teaspoons of baking powder. We have 1 jumbo-sized teaspoon of pumpkin pie spice. Now, if you don't have this, you can just mix together cinnamon and nutmeg and ginger and cloves. You can probably put more than a teaspoon. I did. I like a lot of spice. I did like a heaping teaspoon plus a little extra. And I got out my handy dandy mixer, and we're going to beat these 2 eggs in this large bowl that is way too big. And we're going to combine these things. But before we do any of that, we are going to... Hi, Samson. We're going to set our heat here for 350, and we're gonna let that preheat the oven, and then we're gonna butter this pan. So I have this little block of butter here. I guess you can use oil. I think butter is a little bit tastier if there is any kind of flavor that lingers. So you just wanna rub this, make sure it's a little bit soft on the edges and on the side. I can't do this with one hand, but this will keep it from sticking. Okay, we just ran 7 miles with the jogger stroller, and I will tell you guys, no joke, I used to run like so much more than this. It feels like it's like 3 times the amount it actually is. Colin is really enjoying scratching on the side. He thinks it's pretty funny. Yes, he does. All right, so we're gonna talk about portable defibrillators. Okay, so for some reason my music today was stuck on like random of songs that I've never even picked. I don't know. So all these like 80s pop songs started coming on, and they were pretty terrible, and I just wanted to get it over with, and I wanted these things out of my ears. So between that and our long run with the jogger stroller up the hills, just in case I needed a portable defibrillator, let's hope I don't. We're going to talk about this one. So let me think here. Okay, where should I begin? All right. So obviously it began in Ireland, and it was by James Francis Partridge. I don't know why they always need to put middle names. Like, I guess the guy's a celebrity. I don't know. That's how you know you've made it, I guess, if you have your middle name and something. Sorry, guys. I'm still out of breath. I literally just finished like 2 minutes ago. All right. So anyway, he was a physician and a cardiologist who served in World War II. He was a pathology lecturer at Belfast Queen University. He established famous specialist unit at, I guess it was Royal Victoria Hospital. Yes, guys, I am reading this because I don't have this memorized, which they introduced modern CPR at this hospital. I have given that before. It's not as easy as they make it look. The first model was in 1965, and it weighed 70 kilograms. I thought that was like nothing, but Apparently that translates into 154 pounds. That's more than I weigh, if that tells you anything. Nowadays, it's only 3 kilograms, which is 6.5 pounds. That's a little more like it. So I guess if you're if you're shocked by these facts, at least we can shock you back to life, I guess. I don't know, guys. This is my real life right now. Colin's been saying dada for like the entire time. We got a nice day at least. Okay, guys, that rant's over. See you later. Okay, I'm now mixing all of my dry ingredients. You're supposed to whisk it. It doesn't really matter, guys. I don't know why people are so particular. In fact, usually when they say alternate ingredients, I just dump them all in. It's totally fine. It's never gone bad, other than the time I burnt sugar on the stove a few years ago, but that didn't have anything to do with mixing ingredients, so we should be good. Okay, all right, guys, I should know better than to try a sugar dish again. It's been a few years, if you remember what happened last time where I destroyed a few pans. All right, so we are now going to mix our stuff in there, and then we're going to add our eggs. Okay, I finished beating my eggs. Hopefully nobody calls the hotline on me. I'm going to take this and actually just dump it into this, guys, because this is how I roll on days that there's no dishes in the house. So I just have a smaller bowl that I transferred this into, and then I'm going to add my dry ingredients, mix my alien stew, and then add the eggs at the end here. I'm gonna rinse this out first just so it's not lingering. By the way, guys, I have something to say about this. So I read that you're actually, technically in the tradition, you're supposed to use tea that was already had, like it's supposed to be leftover tea, and you're not supposed to use tea bags. That's rubbish according to the recipe. So, oh, and it says if you do this, you're gonna have like bad luck for years. So, my life should be interesting. Oh, my oven is finished. We'll see what happens down the road. Okay, guys. All right, we're gonna start mixing these things now. Okay, you guys, once you've hit the hospital from your cardiac event, let's hope you're properly medicated with none other than sparkling water. Okay, yes, you guys. So a man by the name of JJ, like, or Lucille or something like that, invented sparkling water, okay? And I guess he thought it would cure scurvy for some odd reason, so he gave it to Captain Cook's crew on their second voyage to the South Seas. As you may have guessed, it probably didn't do a whole lot, but a few years later, a man by the name of Schweik stole his idea, / adopted it, and sold it in his business to make money. It just goes to show you guys that if you tell anybody that anything is worth their money, they will probably buy it in more ways than one. So there you have it, sparkling water. And I'm at Pins Mechanical right now. Colin is over there. I don't know if you can see him, but my husband is chasing him around. He has vacated the premises. and I chose to record here because when I was pregnant, we used to come here a lot. And I used to smuggle in this sparkling water. I used to get in big trouble. There he comes over here. And even now I can drink beer, and I can pay for their beer and drink it. I still smuggle in sparkling water. I just drink both. So I should have just told them it's my prescription. yeah, he's ready to go play. So, all right, you guys, that's our cure for the day, sparkling water. Oh boy, guys, this smells very tea. Tea. Technically, you're supposed to like alternate this and the eggs. I'm just not, because I'm doing it with my left hand while I'm trying to record. So, okay, so I'm gonna mix this together. Ooh, doesn't this look yummy, you guys? this is what happens if you don't pull the sticker off that lemon and you're a cat. Oh man, you guys, I've had a lot of green tea today. Okay, so we're gonna finish mixing this up until there's no dry, clumpy stuff ready to go here. And then we're gonna add our eggs in our much smaller bowl. Okay, we are back at another park here. I'll explain this here in a second, but we are walking at a reservation where my husband and I trained for Kilimanjaro. Colin is here down there. I can't really show you guys. We're headed to the swing. We tried a stationary thing. That didn't work out. If you ever have a kid, you know that you can't stop moving, like ever. So we're gonna talk about our next invention, which is indeed color photography. Yes, you guys. So in our Cinco de Mayo video, we talked about our color TV coming from Mexico. Well, color photography actually comes from Ireland. So we can head to our two favorite places to see some good old fashioned color. Colin loves color. I even brought his rainbow ball with him today.
Say hi, Colin.
I just had to show you guys, he's actually there. Anyway, so I memorized this one, guys, and I'm no longer running and sweaty, so I can actually like look at the camera. We are at our reservation here because it is indeed becoming spring in Cleveland. And as you see, this nice wide array of brown trees and gray water could use some good old touch-up color photography. Also, it's my entire hobby, and if there was no color photography, I might be like, I don't know, like in some kind of, I don't know, place where I'm not myself. I don't know. Okay, guys, sorry, it's been a long day. Okay, so color photography was actually invented by John Jolly. This is no like one-time thing either. He invented a lot of things, one of which was treating cancer with radiation. Another which was developing the photometer, which measures, I guess, light intensity. The meltometer, which measures melting intensity or melting points. And let's see, what else did he invent? Oh yeah, the constant gas volume thermometer, amongst other things. So this was like his side hobby, okay? Overachiever here. So, I guess a lot of other people were trying to develop something at the same time, but they were unsuccessful. And this guy just waltzed along and said, I think I'm going to invent this color photography. And so he did. And it has something to do, I'm not even going to pretend to understand, but something to do with the colored lines and the viewing plates, whatever those things are. Colin seems to know what those are. So here we are at almost sunset, enjoying our color photography. Yes, it's good to see green here in Northeast Ohio. You don't usually see that unless I'm wearing it. And Colin is getting ready to go on the swings. I don't know why I'm rewarding him. He is not happy about my videos lately. So, but we're gonna go on the swings anyway and take some color photography pictures. Okay, this has been like 3 minutes, I need to stop. Okay, we've made it to the swing successfully with no meltdowns because we're not sitting still anymore. Just had to show you guys where we actually are. So I'm gonna enjoy his green clothing and my own green clothing and take a few pictures. Okay, it's mixed enough that I'm gonna pour in my eggs and I'm gonna mix this now. It's starting to smell and look like bread pudding just a bit. It's kind of magical, you guys. I don't know how it's gonna taste, but we'll find out. All right, guys, we're going to talk about tanks now. I'm throwing tanks on Colin's head. He loves clothing for some odd reason. He loves nothing more than to go through like aisles upon aisles of dresses. But don't ask me why, guys. He's going to be my shopping buddy one of these days. Boom. Okay, so we're going to talk about tanks. Not these kind of tanks, though. We're going to talk about the tanks from the military. Okay, this one was invented by somebody that Winston Churchill appointed. His name was Walter. And Walter, let me see what his actual name was because I can't remember what it is. It was Walter Gordon. Sorry, that's what it was. I thought I could memorize this and all I had to remember was one whole name. Couldn't even do that. So Walter Gordon decided to create the tank, which was supposed to be resistant to mud and could plow through barbed wire and could go through any trench. So that was the goal. Nowadays, tanks look a lot different than original tanks did back in the day. Definitely don't look like ones that Colin can play peekaboo with. But there you have it, guys. Tanks did indeed come from Ireland, from Walter Gordon. After a hard-working day on the farm, we all go to sleep at night. Okay, so this is the part we have to talk about. Okay, this is the point where we put our charm in there. I'm going to explain what the traditional charms are. So if you see something like a ring in there, that's supposed to be that you're going to marry, and then you're supposed to put the ring under your pillow and think about the person you're going to marry and your dreams. It's supposed to come true. If you put a piece of cloth in there, it means you're going to have bad luck. I don't know about you guys, but I don't want to be eating my t-shirt any more than my one-year-old son already does. If you put a dried pea in there, the person will not marry. Okay. Interesting. And if you put a coin in there, you're going to be rich. So here's what was my idea. Okay, I think we all want to be rich. At least I do. I was about to totally put like one of these Mardi Gras coins that I got from New Orleans this year. However, then I had this like horrible thought that these are like not good to bake because I don't know. Look at the color and who knows what might happen, what kind of chemicals. So we're just like not going to do that. But I am going to put this plastic baby. Yes, I just have this on hand, guys. In fact, I have about like 300 of these from my gender reveal party like 2 years ago. This is what they traditionally put in a king cake of Mardi Gras. This is, if you get it, it's good luck. And the next person, the person that gets the baby, is supposed to buy the king cake the next year. This seemed a little bit safer. So I'm crossing Mardi Gras with our Halloween bread here. And also, by the way, guys, I was the first one that ever got this before I even knew what king cake was. I freaked out that I had this thing in my mouth, and ever since, it seems like I get this every year. So, am I lucky? I don't know. At least it'll be offset by maybe this bad tea I used here. So, we're gonna hide this in the dough. I'm just gonna, like, drop the baby in there. This is an interesting one, guys. Aren't you glad you tuned in today? I'm just gonna bury him in there. I'm also gonna inspect, like, each piece. If my son Colin eats this, I don't want him choking on any babies or having any, any bad things happen. Okay, so I mixed it in there. No cannibalism here. All right, now we're going to put this in our dish here. Now, it did say to use a deep dish 9-inch pan. I'm like just a rebel here and using a deep dish square pan because I don't have any deep dish 9-inch pans. I only have the shallow one, so I think it'll serve its purpose. It'll be fine. All right, so we're going to put this in here. We're going to cook it in our 350 oven for 80 to 90 minutes until brown and springy. Seems like it should be more like folly. Man, springy, folly, get it? Okay, all right, guys. Like I said, I had green tea. Okay, so we're going to put this in there and let it cook. Okay, we're up to our next Irish invention, which is indeed the submarine. That's right, you guys. The submarine came from Ireland, so I didn't know this, and I just found this out on Saturday when I was doing some research. And I went down to Columbus to this like beer fest with some friends, and it was at a science center, and lo and behold, there is a submarine that you could go into. And I got super excited. I'm like, guys, do you know where these are from? I know exactly where these come from. And people are like, I don't really care. And I'm like, oh, they come from Ireland. And everyone's like, okay, like Marie, I don't really care. But okay. And I was all excited. So I went in it and took some pictures and things like that, like I always do. And so that's my story about Saturday. But yeah, they were invented by the Irish, specifically John Philip Hollard. There we go with the middle names again. He must be important. Actually, he was a true Irishman, as they call him. He didn't even speak English most of his life till adulthood. And he came over to the U.S. and actually, I think he taught. And he was researching he was thinking about the Civil War, because this is around this time, about how he could attack boats underwater. And he came up with this idea of the submarine, right? And of course, this was like immediately shut down because, I mean, like a boat underwater attacking boats, like, come on now, like that doesn't sound. But like most things, nothing sounds all that plausible until it happens. So that just goes to show that any idea can come reality if you have enough funding and enough persistence. So this guy really pushed his idea, and eventually the U.S. Navy did buy his prototype of the submarine. So he did eventually become famous enough to have a middle name, and his name went talked about. So yes, the submarine came from Ireland, in case you ever wanted to know that, or you're at the Cosay Center in Columbus and you want to impress your friends. All right, and this is what it looks like going in. It's no longer alien stew, but in fact what looks like cat barf. just in case you guys are really hungry and want to hear about that. And here we go, and we'll see it in like 80 to 90 minutes. Okay, that brings us to our next point, which, as you see, we're at our favorite restaurant, and Colin is using here Wi-Fi. he needs it here. This is entertainment, or one of them anyway, amongst many other things. So Wi-Fi indeed came from, say hi, from Ireland. So it was invented by a man by the name of John O'Sullivan. He actually accidentally discovered it, if that makes any sense. So he was actually trying, so get this, he was it was like a byproduct of, I don't know what this is, guys, but CSIRO is a research project. And it was a failed experiment. He thought that he could detect exploding mini black holes the size of atomic particles by inventing what is now Wi-Fi. That was a failure. That didn't really work out. But 20 years later, it was used by the entire world, Wi-Fi. So somehow that turned into what we now use every day. I guess everything is a failure by name only. So nothing is really a failure. That's just a good lesson we can learn there. Colin, are you enjoying your Wi-Fi?
Yeah.
We are. We're enjoying yogurt clusters a bit more. But yes, Wi-Fi is from Ireland. Colin, are we going to look at our bread? Is it finished? We're not going to have Cheerios right now. Colin, come look. Let's go see. It looks like it's done. Actually, guys, it's only been about, I guess, 65 minutes or so. Colin, don't touch this. We'll eat some later. So, yes, I'd say this is done. It's definitely springy and fally for sure. It smells really good in here. Like I said, it only took about 65 minutes or so, and I guess we'll try it. Don't forget, guys, you have to have butter on hand because, like, that's the thing. You're supposed to spread butter on top. If you have some leftover from our greasing our pan, you can just spread that. Seems like they like leftovers, so I guess that would be maybe undoing our tea that we made fresh that we're not supposed to do. All right, guys, we will try this in a minute. Okay, we're up to the second to last thing that came from Ireland, and that is indeed chocolate milk. Colin is getting ready to try it for the first time. He's never had it before, so we'll see how this goes. Chocolate milk was invented by a man by the name of Hans Sloan, and he was a physician and a collector, I think he was, and he was traveling to Jamaica, and the locals there were putting, like, water and cocoa powder together, and it was like really disgusting to him, and he was like repulsed by this. So he decided to put milk and cocoa powder together, which is actually what this is, and he's like, that's a little bit more tolerable, I think. So he brought it back home with him, and to this day everybody drinks chocolate milk. I hope this is like okay. I think I used to put chocolate syrup in my milk, but we're gonna go with cocoa powder today because that's all I had. So we'll see how it goes. We're also gonna try our Barmbrack. I know I try to put bananas in all of our dishes every year, but I felt like that was like too normal because there's already fruit in here, but you can definitely still eat it with a banana. In fact, I might give Colin some banana with his Barmbrack. So we'll see how it goes. This one's too regular, guys. I know I'm disappointing this year. All right, let's give it a try. Okay, guys, we're going to try our Barmbrack now, and Colin's going to have his chocolate milk. I don't know how we're going to do with that, if he's going to like it. I think he's all right with it. We didn't want to dirty his beautiful sweater here. He has his Taco Tuesday bib on. We've got our Barmbrack. I did take the liberty of dicing up some bananas, guys. I couldn't go without tradition, so I'm going to get that bowl. We'll probably get overturned at some point. The best way to do this, guys, is to put butter on the top. So spread it with butter. That's the traditional thing. No? He's going for the bananas. We'll see what happens. Colin, do you like it? Do you like it? More? You've got a whole bowl for full. He likes more. All right, I'm going to give mine a try here. All right, let's see here. That's very good. And guys, I promise you I'm not doing this intentionally, but guess what I got? I swear, I'm Dustin. I did indeed get the plastic baby all covered in bread and butter and bananas. And oh my God, I tried really hard to not give myself that. I had a whole entire batch of it. I did make sure Colin didn't get it. I got it as per typical me. Colin, do you like this at all? Are you not a fan? I'm surprised, guys. He normally likes sweet things. Take a bite. He likes bread normally. Okay, we'll see if he'll eat the rest. I know he's looking at me like I'm up to no good, which I am. Is that good? What do you think? Yes, Colin. I think he likes it. He's giving it a second try. He's like his mother. I'll try anything twice. That's my motto. So Colin will apparently try anything more than twice. I'm not sure how that chocolate milk is doing, but we're going to make a stab in our BARMBRACK, and I will see you on our last thing that came from Ireland. More? I got a whole bowl. I think he likes it. Do you like it, Colin? No, you don't like it?
I am a little beggar man, a beggar I have been for 80 and more in this little lily green. I'm known from the Liffey down to Seguin, and I'm known by the name.
There goes our BARMBRACK. Of all the traces going, I should beg and is the best. Okay, we're up to our final thing that comes from Ireland, and that is indeed boycotts. Okay, Colin, don't be getting any ideas. He already has ideas about that. Hi guys, I did kind of need to take some notes on this one, so I do have to look at this. But boycotts started actually during the land war of the 19th century. So there was like a dispute going on amongst some villagers. Landowners weren't getting rights to their land, and the tenants of it's called Boycott's Estate protested against the meager reductions in rent and threatened evictions after a poor harvest. Oh man. No violence was used there, guys. They just refused to work in the fields, in the stables. And they refused to deliver any mail. Okay, that's a good punishment. Poor Boycott had to like import people to work for him, and he eventually gave up and left Ireland, so that worked out pretty well. I guess nobody really needs tanks there when you've got mail to take away and you're not getting your fresh fruits and veggies. So that's more punishment than he probably needed. Colin loves his fruits and veggies though, don't you, Colin? Yeah, he does. He loves it. You heard him yourself, guys. He loves his fruits and veggies. Alright guys, so why am I doing this at the end? Because I'm getting ready to clean up Colin's face. We are going to clean up, and he notoriously hates having his face cleaned. So you guys are going to witness a live boycott. Okay, we're all finished. Yes, Colin, no more. We are going to spoil our dinner. I don't think we're a huge fan of chocolate milk. We've got most of it still. All right, guys, we are going to clean up. Just bear with me on this. I know what's coming. All right, Colin, we'll clean up the rest later, but we're going to clean your face. This is our boycott at its finest. Yes, boycott. No fruits and veggies or mail for Mama for the next, God knows, 3 seconds until he forgets about this. All right, you guys, boycott it is. Guys, that concludes our annual video for St. Patrick's Day. I hope you all enjoyed. Got some interesting fun facts. Colin has since gotten over his boycott. He's calling the hotline again on me. and I forgot to show you guys where Ireland is. Ireland is indeed It's in Northern Europe. It's a little island. I think I had it on Ireland, and then I spun it all the way around. It's this little bird-looking country right there. So if you ever think about Ireland, it looks sort of like a bird. Anyway, that's where it is, and I'm sad to see you guys go. You know how I feel about Les. Colin had fun. We stained our shirt just a bit, but he wants to stay so long, and then he's still mad at me for taking away the crumbs and for making him wash his face. Colin, can you say bye? Okay, we've got snacks. All right, guys. We'll see you later. Colin, can you say bye-bye? Say bye-bye. Can you say bye-bye? Bye-bye. All right, we're going to go wipe our nose and experience another boycott. Bye-bye, everyone. Happy St. Patrick's Day.